Good morning, ClearView. Let's stand together. Let's worship the Lord.
Who brings the power of sin and darkness? Who still is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King of the King. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King of kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. May you would take my place. May you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. You've done for me. Yeah, Lord, you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the open a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations, the truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all its radiance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross.
Their voice sing, worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy is. Yeah. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, I sing of all you've done. All you've done in my life. All you've done. This is grace. This is amazing grace.
Let's give the Lord a cup of grace this morning. Yeah.
Over the water to become the blood. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. And Spirit is moving over the water to become the blood. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Now come. fill the room. You're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me down, down. Spirit, when you move, make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me.
Spirit.
Your word remains the same. Ooh, your history can prove there's nothing you can do. You're faithful and true.
Though the storms,
though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I will remain steadfast and let my heart know when you speak of it will come to pass. Great is your faith.
Sing, I put my faith in Jesus.
I put my faith in Jesus, my anchor to the ground, my hope and foundation. He'll never let me down.
I put my faith in Jesus, my anchor to the ground, my hope and foundation. He'll never let me down. He'll never let me down.
Great is your faithfulness to me.
Great is your faithfulness to me.
From the rising sun to the setting, say, I will praise your name.
Great is your faithfulness to me.
Great is your faithfulness. Sing that again.
Great is your faithfulness to me.
Great is your faithfulness.
Jesus, great is your faithfulness, O God. God, we declare that today. We speak it over our lives, our circumstances, the things that we carry, the things that we've brought with us this morning, the things that are coming off of our week and our weekend. As we start our week today, this Sunday morning, in your house, to say, great is your faithfulness. And because I know that you've been faithful in my past, I know that you are faithfully active in my present, but I also know that faithfully you were working out the details of our future. And so, God, I pray that right now over your people. Lord, great is your faithfulness. Lord, we love you, we honor you, and we adore you, not because of what you can do, but because of who you are, the very character and nature of you, Almighty God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, ClearView Church. We are so excited that you're here today. I have a few announcements that I want to make sure get on your calendar. This coming Wednesday is the final Wednesday night service for 21 days of prayer and fasting. Don't miss it. 7 o'clock right here in this building, an awesome time in the Word and in worship, and ClearView Kids is going to continue our time in El Salvador and BGMC. You definitely want to be here. Coming up on January 23rd, I have two very special announcements. First, we have a water baptism service. Water baptism is simply an outward expression of an inward decision. It's an opportunity to say that I have decided to follow Jesus with my whole heart, my whole life, and I want my family and my church family to, one, know that, two, celebrate with me, and three, help keep me accountable to God's word. And that's what we're here to do, celebrate with you, excited for the number one best decision you will ever make in your life. If you're interested in water baptism, you can sign up at clearviewchurch.net or see Pastor Donovan or any of our staff members, and they will help answer any questions you have and get you directed to the website so you can sign up and be a part of that service. The second thing on January 23rd, everybody listen, turn your ear towards me. This is important. There's one service January 23rd. Everybody say it with me because I didn't hear you say it. Ready? One, two, three. One service. Good job, those of you in the back. It's at 10:30. You definitely want to be here. It is a celebration service. We have so many things to share with you. We can't tell you all the details yet. It's a surprise. So you absolutely want to be here. Bring everybody you know, because we have some incredible news and some amazing things that we want to celebrate with you. January 23rd, one service at 10:30. Finally, coming up on January 30th, Sunday night at 5 p.m. is our annual business meeting. This is such an important meeting to be a part of. One, because we get to share with you all the things that God has done this past year. Things that have been seen and unseen, exciting and amazing miracles of God. And the other thing that's so important about being here is that you get to hear the vision and the plan for this next year right here on your ClearView Church campus. We are so excited for all that God is doing, all that He has yet to do, and we are believing that He has so much more to do than we can even imagine. And let me tell you, we can imagine big. So God has big plans for this church and this community. Now, I hope your heart is ready. I pray that your heart is ready, your mind is ready. We're going to dig into God's word today and get ready to worship Him together.
Good to be in God's house.
Amen. Amen.
It doesn't matter what your week looked like, your weekend looked like. We're starting our week off right in His house, in His presence, allowing Him to do what only He can do. Amen?
Amen.
So we're in our series, Fresh. Everybody say Fresh.
Fresh.
Okay, I believe wholeheartedly God wants to do something fresh in your life. I think He always wants to do something fresh. In week one, we talked about fresh fruit. All right, and if you weren't here for week one or you didn't tune in online, right, fresh fruit. We believe wholeheartedly that God wants to do fresh fruit in our church. That's salvations, baptisms, child dedications, baptism in the Holy Spirit, people getting involved in dream teams and serving God's house, but serving His heart by serving His house in small groups. And then we believe wholeheartedly, last week as we preached on and learned about a fresh wind and fire, the Holy Spirit. How many know that you need the Holy Spirit in your life?
Amen. Amen.
And so as we go through this today, we're talking about fresh anointing. Everybody say anointing?
Anointing.
We're going to talk about what that is, the definitions, its meanings, its nature. And then we're going to look at scripture. And then we're going to get back into a time of worship. And it's very simple. During that time of worship, I'm going to invite you to the altar and we're going to anoint you. We're going to have an anointing service, okay? And it's nothing crazy. It's nothing cuckoo, but we're going to explain everything. We're going to teach through it. We're going to walk through it. And then basically at the end of the service, if you're saying, I am a believer in Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, and I want the Holy Spirit to do Holy Spirit's work in me so that I can carry out Holy Spirit's work everywhere that I go, we want to anoint you and set you apart. Sound good? So I just want to set up the service so that way you know where we're heading. It's not a ton of teaching today as much as it is just being in His presence and letting God do only what God can do in our lives. So we will be in Luke chapter 4, and we will be in Acts chapter 10. Our verse for the year is this, Isaiah 43:19. See, I'm about to do a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the desert. I am putting streams in the wasteland. How many of you are grateful that God is doing a new thing? I said it this way in when we talked about our fresh fruit, is how many of you ever had like the, just that craving for that big bag of chips that's in the pantry, right? And it's been open, and the last person didn't quite seal it, and then you're really excited. I see husbands and wives just nudging each other, so I'm going to look away. No, I'm just kidding. But you ever gone to that, and you're just so looking forward to that, just that fresh, crisp chip bite, right? But how many know that, like, if it's stale, you put it in and you spit it out, right? And I believe wholeheartedly that as you walk with Jesus and as you walk and the Holy Spirit empowers you, I believe wholeheartedly that God is constantly wanting to do something fresh in your life. So anointing is this. By definition, it's to rub oil or sprinkle oil, all right? We have anointing oil. No, it's not the $100 stuff from Israel. It's olive oil, okay? It is the representation of oil. the presence of God. Okay, to rub or sprinkle an oil, to consecrate or make sacred in ceremony, that includes applying oil. And then the third definition is this, to dedicate to the service of God. How many of you are ready to dedicate to the service of God? That means I put down my preferences and I pick up my purpose. It means I say, I see the situation and the circumstances that surround my life, but the one that is in me is greater than the world around me. It means that we as a church recognize that even though I have the privilege of being the pastor, Christ is the head of the church. Yeah. It's recognizing that even Christ, and we're going to talk about it today, needed the power of the Holy Spirit to do the ministry and the mission that he carried forward. The meaning of anointing is this. It means being sanctified by Holy Spirit to live in the ways of Holy Spirit. Sanctified is a big term that just means the process of becoming more like Christ. So it's Holy Spirit doing his job in your life to produce you to become more like Christ. It's you yielding to God's purpose and plan for your life over your personal preferences and allowing the Holy Spirit to do a work in your life because God created you with a plan and a purpose. It's acknowledging that I am fearfully and wonderfully made in the image of Almighty God for a plan and a purpose. Can I tell you something? That you and I are uniquely designed. And I thank God for that. Or we'd all look the same. And we all sound the same, we all act the same, we all talk the same. But I thank God for our differences because it gives us the opportunity to shine a light into the community from a different viewpoint, into different people's lives in a different way. The nature of anointing is this. It's a verb referring to the process of getting someone to follow the ways of God through Holy Spirit. Now, something that we need to see and understand is this, is the Holy Spirit is inclusive. Holy Spirit is for everybody. Everybody say, the Holy Spirit's for everybody. Okay? Holy Spirit's made available for everybody. I believe wholeheartedly before somebody becomes a Christian, Holy Spirit is active on their behalf because I believe that God's placed you in the path of people who don't know him yet, and through the Holy Spirit working in your life, you're shining a light into their life. Amen? So Holy Spirit's active in the life of somebody who doesn't acknowledge Christ as their Savior because God has placed you with the Holy Spirit in you to empower you to be a light into their life. The Holy Spirit is for everybody, but one of the things we need to see is the anointing is exclusive. The anointing is as different as your fingertips. If the anointing wasn't exclusive, I bet all of the Old Testament people would be like, give me Elijah. Right? Elijah wouldn't have waited for Elisha to say, give me a double portion. See, the Holy Spirit's for everybody, but God uniquely anoints each and every one of us for the mission to carry forward what Jesus started. And the beautiful part about that is you walk in circles and live in communities that I don't. Therefore, together as one body of believers, God has anointed us differently to reach different people, to love different people, so that all people could have an opportunity to hear the gospel and the good news of Jesus Christ. So again, at the end of service, and they come up to play, and we worship, and we're going to worship through and worship through, I want to encourage you, if you want Holy Spirit to do Holy Spirit's work in you so that you can carry out the Holy Spirit's work into your community, into your job, in your family, in your marriage, in your neighborhood, wherever you are, can I tell you, you're called to build the kingdom of God. And you cannot do that apart from Holy Spirit empowering you. Right? We talked about it, John 15. He's the vine, we're the branches. If we remain in him and he remains in us, we bear much fruit. But the other side of that to understand is in order for Jesus to carry the mission that God sent him to earth to do, Holy Spirit had to lead him. We're going to get to that in just a minute through our text today. But I want us to see that is that the Holy Spirit is for everybody. Some of us have put Holy Spirit in a box and said, well, because I grew up thinking this or believing that, but the Holy Spirit isn't for me. The Holy Spirit was for those in time of the scripture. And here's what's awesome. We're going to dig through in Acts chapter 10 about Peter sharing and the Holy Spirit empowering the Gentiles and the Jews having their eyes opened. And we're going to talk about in Luke chapter 4, Jesus returning into his ministry. So without further ado, let's get to Luke chapter 4. We're going to be in verses 14 through 19. In order to understand 14 through 19 that we're going to read, you need to understand that Luke chapter 4 starts with the temptation of Jesus in the desert. Now, what happened prior to the temptation of Jesus in the desert was Jesus's what? Baptism. Right? Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist, who was called to prepare the way for Jesus. And in Luke chapter 4, it picks up and says, Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the desert, where 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them, he was hungry. Now, we're not going to go into the rest of that text, but I needed to set that up for you to understand where we're going in our text today. At the end of that portion, after he gets tempted, and after he responds to the devil's temptation with scripture and walks him through that he is Jesus, this is what he says. All right, Luke chapter 4, verses 14 through 19, right? Jesus is rejected at Nazareth. Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Holy Spirit, and news about him spread through the whole countryside. He taught in their synagogues, and everyone praised him. He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day, he went into the synagogue, as was his custom, and he stood up to read. The scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written. Now, I don't think that it's circumstance and just happenstance that Jesus was handed this scroll of Isaiah. I don't think it was any circumstance or happenstance that Jesus rolled down to this portion. In verse 18, this is Jesus reading the words of Isaiah in the synagogue teaching. The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed and to proclaim, watch this, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Now, as we look at that, we see a couple of things. One, when Jesus returned to Nazareth, he went to the synagogue just like he would normally do. So in the middle of something that he would normally do, in his just walking through everyday life, he goes to the synagogue to teach. They hand him the scroll of Isaiah. He scrolls down to this portion, and this is what he does. When he reads Isaiah, Isaiah, remember, being a book of the prophets, is prophesying towards the future, and Jesus is basically revealing himself, saying, I am. Watch this. Jesus is proclaiming to be the anointed one, right? The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me. Now, if we look at it this way, in the Hebrew, he's saying, I'm the Messiah. In the Greek, he's saying, I'm the Christ. He's saying, I'm the King of Kings, and the King has come. I'm the one that you've all been looking for. I'm the one that the prophets have been testifying towards. He's saying, I'm the one that you have all been waiting for. I'm the Messiah. I'm the Christ. I'm the King of Kings. Then he sets out his mission. So the first thing he does is he establishes what? I'm the anointed one. Messiah and Christ. Establishing both in Hebrew and Greek, the Messiah and Christ. And then Jesus' mission is set up in there. I have come to set the captives free, open blind eyes, set free the oppressed, and proclaim the year of the Lord, or the year of Jubilee. Now think of it from this perspective. Jesus came to set the captives free. How many of you are thankful that Jesus came to set us free?
Amen.
What did he set us free from? Sin. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. Well, how complicated is it to be set free from your sin? Those that confess with their mouth Jesus is Lord, believe in their heart God raised him from the dead, they'll be saved. Romans 10:9. It's not complicated. As a matter of fact, God laid out the plan of redemption as pretty simple and straightforward as it is. I will send my son to die on a cross so that every person who hears the gospel and the good news would have an opportunity to repent from their sin and walk with Jesus. So he sets the captive free. He opens the blind eyes. There were people walking, even Jews that were walking in that time frame, that couldn't see that God had sent Jesus to be the Messiah. There were people in the temple that day that couldn't see that God had sent Jesus to be the Messiah. He went to open blind eyes so that they could have revelation of what Scripture prophesied to who he is. And then he set free the oppressed. And then he proclaimed the year of Jubilee. And now here's the awesome thing. Is that not our mission, to proclaim the year of the Lord? Is it not our mission to set captives free through the power of Jesus and share the gospel and express the gospel of peace and give every opportunity for somebody to experience freedom in Christ? I don't know about you, but I'm so grateful I'm not the person I was before Christ. Amen? And I'm grateful that what God has done in my life, he can do in anyone's life. And that drives me to just being able to share the gospel with whoever I come in contact with, to create an opportunity to love them to Jesus, because Jesus loved me way more beyond what I deserved. To set the to set free the oppressed. There are people who live oppressed in the way of the world when God wants to bring forth the way of the kingdom in their lives. They've just never heard it. They've never seen it. They've never experienced the freedom found in the blood of Jesus. They've never experienced the power of the Holy Spirit. They've never experienced, guess what? We have a responsibility to be the hands and feet of Jesus, to love people, to point them to him. Guess what? God has, if you are a follower of Jesus, God has anointed and appointed you for such a time as this, in the unique circles in which you walk, in the communities in which you live, the schools in which you, your kids go to, the families in which you are connected to, for such a time as this, to point them to Jesus. That doesn't change, it doesn't shift. You're anointed and appointed to do so. You're set apart for the work of the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit does his work in you so he can do it through you. And you don't lack anything for the work that God calls you to, because the Lord is my shepherd and I lack nothing. Because I lack nothing, then I know that I have everything I need for such a time as this. So if you want the Holy Spirit to do Holy Spirit's work in you so that you can then carry out the Holy Spirit's work, guess what? You just have to do what we talked about last week. Receive it. Right? You're not building something. God's building something.
Right.
You're just making available the landscape for him to dress up. You're just making available the landscape for him to put on a show so that people can see the goodness of him through you. Because I'll tell you what, the world gets dark. The world gets ugly. The world gets messy. But by the grace of God, his light exposes what's in the darkness. By the grace of God, the mess of the world gets cleaned up by his righteousness, not by yours. So when you make yourself available to him, then the Holy Spirit does what he can do and then empowers you to do what he's called you to do. So now we're going to jump over into Acts chapter 10. In Acts chapter 10, I'm going to read more than verses 38 to 37, or 37, 38, but that's where we're going to land. And it says this. We're going to pick up in verse 34 to 48 in Acts chapter 10. It says this. Then Peter began to speak. I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts men from every nation who fear him and do what is right. You know the message of God, you know the message God sent to the people of Israel, telling the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. You know what happened and what has happened throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism John preached. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him. I've got good news for you. God is with you.
Amen.
Therefore, the work that God has called you to do, you're capable of doing simply because God is with you. And here's the awesome thing. Peter's sitting in a room, right, with believers and Jewish believers, Jewish Christians of the time, but he's also sitting in a room of Gentiles, of people from whom had not necessarily heard the word. They've seen it. That's why he's saying that a little bit earlier in the passage. He's saying, you know what has happened throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, right? Jesus was anointed with Holy Spirit and power as he walked into his ministry. Jesus needed the Holy Spirit and power. You and I need the Holy Spirit and power. And he went around doing good, healing all who are under the power of the devil, because God was with him. We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a cross. But God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all people, but by witnesses whom God had already chosen, by us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God appointed as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of his sins through his name. While Peter was still speaking, these words, the Holy Spirit came on all who heard the message, the circumcised believers, the Jewish believers who had come with Peter were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on the Gentiles, for they heard them speaking in tongues and praising God. Then Peter said, "Can anyone keep these people from being baptized with water? They have received the Holy Spirit just as we have, so we ordered that they be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ." I've got good news for you. And that good news is the Holy Spirit is for everyone.
Amen.
I've got good news for you. The anointing God wants to put on your life is so uniquely designed and dynamically planned out for you. How amazing is that? And the other thing I love in here is Peter doesn't go in, and in the text it doesn't cover it. So Peter doesn't go in and say, "Well, now we have to walk around and see, okay, well, do you believe that Jesus is Lord?" He says, "Man, if the Holy Spirit's baptized them, then what's stopping them from proclaiming Jesus as Lord? Let's baptize them in water in the name of Jesus Christ." That's powerful. We got to grab a hold of that. Again, Acts 10, 37, 38. You know what has happened throughout the providence. He's laying the groundwork for them. Beginning in Galilee, after the baptism that John had preached, John's role was to prepare the way for Jesus. Can I tell you something? Our role is to prepare the way for Jesus into the lives of people who have no clue who he is. Right? We need to love people beyond what they deserve because he loved us beyond what we deserve. Our role is to prepare the opportunity. If you walk around and tell everybody to go into hell in a handbasket, very few people will listen to you. But if you walk around and love people the way that Jesus loved you before you were saved and still all kinds of messed up, if you walk around and you love somebody, again, beyond what they deserve, simply because Jesus loved you beyond what you deserve. Because here's the deal. I got a secret to tell you. I'm a sinner. So are you. And so are they. But for some reason, they just haven't had the revelation that Jesus is my Lord and Savior, and I can be forgiven of my sins. But guess what? Holy Spirit wants to do a work in you so that he can empower you so that they can have an opportunity to experience Jesus in that way. He doesn't hold back here. He says it. What did Jesus do? The Holy Spirit in power. He went around doing good, healing all those who were under the power of the devil because God was with him. Our mission is to go around doing good, healing all those who are under the power of the devil. That doesn't sound complicated, right? Loving people so that Jesus can do a work in their life. Creating every opportunity so that they would be open to a conversation. Nobody ever won an argument by making a point. But people's lives have changed because somebody chose to make a difference. And as we yield to the Holy Spirit working in our lives, guess what comes? The Holy Spirit as our paraclete and our counselor, he also comes in discernment, which means we'll understand what to say and when to say it. We'll see the need and allow God to use us to fill that need. Because God wants to do a work in us, through us. And what's beautiful is, imagine how the world could change if every person in every church that says, "I believe in Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior," would say, "Holy Spirit, I wake up this morning and I yield this day to you. I've got my plans. I've got the things I'm going to be working on." But here's the cool thing, right? If you include Holy Spirit in your plans, he's not caught off guard. He doesn't have to catch you off guard because you're tuned in and waiting for him to move. And can I tell you something? He can move in a business deal. He can move. I'm going to help you with something. If you're retired, he can move in your retirement. If you have air in your lungs and a pulse in your heart, let me tell you, Jesus wants to work in you. Right? I don't want to use that word "use you" because then you feel used. But God wants to do a work in your heart so he can do a work in our world so that our world can look a little bit more like heaven, a little bit more like Jesus.